Hello, hello, welcome to this online event. I'm Carla Cassal, the Executive Coordinator of PUC Rio Grande do Sul Office for International Cooperation. I'll be again the Master of Ceremonies today of this webinar. The first webinar of the series was focused on public policy. Then yesterday we had the institutional perspective of quality discussed. And today we have the webinar incorporating internationalization and quality standards in curriculum design and classroom experience, now a professor perspective. This webinar is promoted by the Center of Internationalization of Education, Brazil, Australia. The center is fruit of a partnership between Pontifícia Universidade Católica do Rio Grande do Sul and the Australian Embassy here in Brazil. The chat function is available for you to make comments or ask questions. And of course, to let us know a little about you. So feel free to use this tool to introduce yourselves, the institution you represent, and the country where you are from. If you want to get a certificate of attendance for this event, please click on the link that we have sent in the chat function right now. Well, now that we are all connected, I would like to thank our guest speakers, Dr. Lina Pelliccione and Dr. Bernardo Bueno for joining us. I'm sure it will be amazing to learn from your experience as professors. I also would like to thank our colleagues from the Australian Embassy in Brazil, our institutional partners, associations, colleagues from other universities, professors, researchers, students, and everyone else who is here with us. Now I'd like to welcome Dr. Lina Pelliccione to deliver her lecture. Professor Lina Pelliccione is the inaugural Vice Chancellor of Curtin Mauritius and commenced her role in January 2019. Prior to this role, Professor Pelliccione held a number of senior positions at Curtin University since she began in a full-time capacity in 2001. Professor Pelliccione was the head of the School of Education in 2010, prior to taking up the role of Deputy Vice Chancellor of the Faculty of Humanities in February 2018. She was selected to attend a number of prestigious courses, such as the Harvard Management Leadership Institute for Higher Education and the Chief Executive Women's Leadership. Her background is in education and innovation, in particular in the field of ICT, information and communication technology. She has researched and lectured in those areas that deal with the integration and effective use of ICT in teaching and learning. Please welcome Dr. Pelliccione.
Thank you, Carla. Thank you very much for the very warm welcome and very kind invitation. It's actually my pleasure to be part of this wonderful initiative. The picture you see in the background is of Curtin Mauritius campus. I typically live and work in Mauritius, but am currently located in Perth, Western Australia. In this session, I'll provide you with some background about Curtin University, our global campuses, and share with you a couple of things. The first one, how we work with our partners to ensure the content and assessments are contextually appropriate. And the second one, the processes and structures the university has established to ensure the quality and comparability of our courses across the campuses. I'll just share my screen. Thank you. There you go. Thank you for your patience. So, Curtin University, I love sharing the mission, and our mission is to transform lives and communities through education and research. We have about 59,000 students, and 25% of these students are actually international. But that 25% actually includes the students in our global campuses. We have almost 4,000 full-time staff, and they're academic as well as professional. We're very fortunate. We have 53% of the domestic market share in Western Australia. In addition to the Perth campus, where I'm currently located in Western Australia, we also have a Kalgoorlie campus in Western Australia. It's actually in the Goldfields, and it focuses mainly on science and engineering. Curtin has four global campuses, and they all encircle the Indian Ocean Rim. We have Mauritius, which is actually the youngest, and it was established in 2018 after a very long partnership with the Charles Telfer Institute. Dubai is a little bit older, and Singapore is about 10 years old, while Malaysia, our oldest campus, global campus, is actually 20 years old. Each of these campuses actually has different partners. So this is the picture in the background, and it's a lovely aerial view of the campus, and you can probably see the beautiful mountains in the background. It's a very beautiful place. It's actually subtropical, and it's an island country in the Indian Ocean, and it's just over 1,130 kilometres east of Madagascar, off the southeastern coast of Africa. Its own outlying territories include Rodrigue Island and other small islands. And it has about 1.3 million people. The Mauritius descendants are European, mostly French settlers, the Franco-Mauritians. And then you have the Afro-Mauritians, the Chinese, so the Sino-Mauritians, and the Indo-Mauritians. Typically, the language is English. They work and business and administration is in English. But as you can imagine, the press is actually in French, which makes my life really interesting with the French newspapers. But the majority of people actually speak Creole. So our Mauritius campus we have over 1,600 students, 95% of them are local, and we've really only started recruiting international students a few years ago. We have about 39 full-time staff, as you can see, and we have many professional staff in supporting the administration and the courses, and you can see a list of our courses. So on this particular slide, what I'd like to share with you is perhaps some of the terms that I use, and I know that most of you will probably be very familiar with these. So we call courses and programs, you know, combinations of smaller units that make up a 3 or a 4 year course. Each course is actually designed around a set of course learning outcomes. And these are outcomes that we actually want our students to achieve. So alongside that, each unit also has a set of learning outcomes. So what you see in front of you are the learning outcomes for one of our units called Game Design Introduction. All of the Curtin units also have a set of graduate attributes, which you can also see on the slide. They are the same for every unit, regardless of the discipline or the course. The design of each unit must actually address each of these attributes that we want all of our students to achieve. You can see that one of the attributes is international perspectives, where they look at valuing the perspective of others, as well as cultural understanding. So these attributes provide a valuable framework which tries to introduce some aspect of internationalization into the curriculum. So with this next slide, it's actually quite a simple slide. So I'd like to walk you through the process for contextualization of the curriculum. It's fairly straightforward. However, it is an iterative process. Most of the courses have been well established prior to introducing them into one of the global campuses. So before introducing a new course into any of the campuses, our Office of Strategy and Planning, which is based in Perth, they conduct an environmental scan and as well as a market analysis. They gather local as well as regional intelligence. Now, this typically informs whether we decide to proceed or not with the course. So if we decide to proceed with the course, then the Office of Learning and Teaching, which is actually on our Mauritius campus, made up of our local staff, they actually review the curriculum and the assessments to identify if there are any issues with any, perhaps if the content doesn't actually align with any of the cultural norms or anything which may cause confusion or grief. This actually doesn't mean that we don't deal with complex or challenging concepts or content. What it means is that we try and deal with them in a culturally appropriate way. Point number three, so this analysis of the curriculum then leads to further discussions with the course coordinator or the discipline leads, and modifications are made if they're required. Now, this discussion is extremely important as it often leads to the addition of a greater variety of more inclusive content. However, it is important to note that it is an Australian degree. So if we're covering a unit like tax law, well, it's the Australian law that's being included. We can include comparisons from Mauritius, but of course, it's actually the focus is the Australian law. And in this case, the content cannot be changed or modified, but we can provide examples for comparison, which are really quite valuable. If the course is being taught for the very first time on the campus, it then needs to be submitted to the Higher Education Commission for approval. Now, they were the Tertiary Education Commission, but now they've actually, since January 2020, they're actually two separate bodies, the Higher Education Commission and the Quality Assurance Authority. So this provides a little bit more complexity for us now. The Higher Education Commission is actually the regulatory body for tertiary education in Mauritius, very much like the Tertiary Education Quality Standards Agency in Australia. And some of you would have heard Dr. Karen Treloar's session the other day. Once the course has been approved, the course is then implemented. The lecturing staff monitor the appropriateness of the content, the assessment and delivery for our Mauritius students throughout the study period and relay any concerns. A unit review is then conducted at the end of the semester. Staff from the campuses look at the student feedback, and our student feedback system is actually called Evaluate. We also look at student progress and their personal reflections of the unit. Depending on the outcome of the analysis of the data, including the reflections of the unit is modified if it's required. But, and often this is the case after the very first iteration, because there are always things that can be improved. Now, what also happens is that the student feedback system provides a mechanism for the lecturer to respond to the feedback in general terms. Now, it is general because the feedback is actually anonymous. The feedback is also included in the next version of the unit outline, indicating to students that the unit has been modified in response to student feedback. And in some cases, there aren't any changes made, but in some there are. We call this closing the loop. Now, this particular slide is focusing on co-designing curriculum. And what I've described is the typical approach when the course has already been designed without the real thought of delivery in another campus. But what has been really exciting to see is that the new courses or courses that are being reviewed, and they are reviewed every 5 years, are considering the delivery in the global campuses. And to me, that's a huge breakthrough and really very exciting. So working together to co-design the curriculum in the early stages is of great benefit and value. Just imagine how much more powerful the process and the curriculum will be. Imagine the depth of the conversations, the sharing of ideas, the opportunity to challenge existing perceptions and mindsets. Our students will reap the benefits and develop a greater capacity for critical thought, which is informed by empathy creativity and collaboration, which we hope will ultimately lead to a better understanding of themselves, of others, and their place in the world. I have included the design thinking approach, as my colleague, Dr. Craig Witt, said in his presentation last year for this same initiative, Design for Educational Innovation and Curriculum Development, outlined a really useful approach to internationalizing the curriculum using this particular design. So this slide is really demonstrates our governance structure and reporting structures. So we have the University Council located at the Perth campus, and then we have those other governance bodies like Academic Board, Global Positioning Committee. We have the Vice Chancellor, and we have the Senior Executive Teams. And my role is particularly, I sit on the Senior Executive Team that reports directly to the Vice Chancellor, and I actually chair the Curtin Mauritius Academic Board, where we actually really look at quality and monitor student success. And we really also look at the comparability of the courses across the different across the different campuses. So the next one slide, and I won't go through all this detail, actually provides a little bit more detail on how we actually put in the different strategies to assure that there is the quality. So we have pre-meetings at the unit level, much like I'm sure most of you do as well. You have assessment moderation, your pre, during, and post. We have very clear marking guides, and you can imagine how essential that would be when you're actually delivering a unit across so many different campuses. Now, the unit reviews, which I explained earlier, they are absolutely crucial. We look at pass rates, we look at student progress, and we look at student feedback, as I mentioned. So at the end of every year, we have an annual review, and that's actually conducted with our campus, and again looking at quality. Each faculty located on the Perth campus, they also conduct an annual review. And so all of that feeds into the course annual reviews, and every 5 years there's actually a school review. So that's really important too. So they're the strategies. Now, I'd really like to finish off with a really exciting project that a collaboration between the Mauritius students and the Mauritius staff with the Perth campus. And it was actually called the Curtin Creative Jam, which sounds a bit like a piece of toast, doesn't it? So what the project actually looked at bringing the two different groups together. And so what the students were asked to do was to conceptualise an engaging and creative digital experience that can help people stay mentally and psychologically healthy. And I've provided a YouTube video for you that you can have a look at in your own time. But it's a wonderful example of bringing the two different cultures together in a really exciting and innovative way and a very inclusive way. So I hope you enjoy that. And I'd really like to thank you very much for listening and for your time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pelliccione, for your relevant contribution on how Curtin Mauritius has incorporated internationalization and quality standards in curriculum design. Well, now I'd like to invite Dr. Bernardo Bueno to deliver his lecture. Dr. Bueno is lecturer in literature and creative writing at PUC Rio Grande do Sul. He teaches in the graduate program in modern languages and serves as director of undergraduate program in creative writing. He has a PhD in creative and critical writing from University of East Anglia, United Kingdom. Dr. Bueno, it is over to you now.
Okay, thank you, Carla. And I would like to start by thanking the university for inviting me to be here today. It's a great honor to be next to Dr. Lina here. And I'll try to do my best to share my experience as a professor and also as a undergraduate course coordinator. So I'll share my screen, and I have a few notes I would like to share. And here it is. Okay, so just a second while I adjust my screen here. And here we go. So as you can see here, so the title of our webinar is quite long, Incorporating Internationalization and Quality Standards in Curriculum Design and Classroom Experiences, a Professor Perspective. It's quite long, it's quite accurate, but I decided to just title my presentation Internationalization and Creative Writing, because that's my area of expertise and that's the experience I would like to share. So I work at the School of Humanities, and I would like to just make a quick introduction. I'm also a writer and a lecturer at the same time. I try to juggle all things at the same time. And I work at the graduate program in letters and also in the undergraduate creative writing course, and where I also act as coordinator. Recently, I've been to Canada for a brief period of postdoctoral research, where I was proposing a project of a digital humanities lab in our university. So I was studying digital humanities there. And by the time I got back to Brazil, it was March 2020. And that means in my first day back, I all the classes were canceled, and everyone knows what happened after that. So I was full of ideas, and some of them had to wait. So my experience my international experience, and I think this is how I ended up here, was because my PhD in England, I lived there for 3 years, where I had the opportunity to develop my English skills in general and my writing skills mostly, and it was quite scary at first, but then I got more comfortable, and I had the chance to travel to meet people from all over the world, and I think I'd like to think I brought that experience with me when I came back to Brazil and started teaching in our university. So a quick note, what I mean by internationalization in my presentation is mostly internationalization at home, and not related. Right now, I'm not talking about mobility and traveling abroad and this kind of thing. I'm mostly talking about how we can make our curriculums and our classes more international. And this is what I mean by internationalization. I would like to start by saying that we are here in Brazil, we are already international, but sort of, because we have access in general, we have access to media, international media. Children are taught English in schools, mostly in private schools, but also in public schools. So that means many children have a basic knowledge of English by the time they graduate in high school. And of course, we have access to the internet, which makes us able to access online content from around the world, of course. But it's not that simple, because of course, language is a barrier. If we don't have enough English skills or any other language skills, we won't be able to enjoy all the content that is available to us. Even so, we have constant access to foreign TV shows, music, movies, and that makes us naturally a bit more welcoming to an international experience. But language is the main barrier here. And when I say that, I say that we need to take into account the inequality and the economic and social gap that we face in Brazil, which is a huge problem in our country. And then I would like to move to a more specific subject. And this is what I would like to share with you, my experience teaching creative writing in English in Brazil. So, and also later, my experience planning the curriculum for a creative writing undergraduate course. So this first experience is started in 2015. So we had around 10 semesters of this class. So creative writing, we have creative writing classes in Portuguese. We have creative writing, the creative writing undergraduate course, and also the master's and PhD. But this is the first class we started teaching in English. Creative writing is an elective class offered every semester. And we have welcomed students from around the university from different courses, such as psychology, architecture, journalism, and of course, creative writing and letters, which is the equivalent of an English course. So, and these students, they have a different backgrounds and they come to this class, this optional class, because they want to try something new or because they already write in English and they want to write literature in English. But one thing I noticed they have in common is an advanced knowledge of English. Because it's a demanding class, not because it's hard, but because the students need to come to this class willing to write, not only write an academic paper in English or just listen to a class in English delivered in English, but they need to be able to or willing to write literature, write poems and short stories in English. And that can be quite intimidating. So when students come to this class, they usually already have an advanced knowledge of English. And some students are worried they won't be able to keep up. And I try to talk to them so they can understand that they will be assessed individually and according to the writing tasks I give them and not comparing one to another. It's a very welcoming class in that sense. And the result is that the students quite like this class. It's quite popular. We also had, on several occasions, we had international students who were spending a semester abroad here in Brazil, and they came to class. They came from France or for Denmark and other countries, Canada, United States, and they come and they want to try something like creative writing, and they are welcome as well. And usually the students are quite happy with this class because it gives them a chance to think about something new, gets them away from their final papers and or whatever it is they are studying, and they can have fun and try to write literature and share their love for books and stories. And it's quite challenging to accommodate different backgrounds, but in the end, it's a very positive experience. And then we have a different kind of internationalization in creative writing, which is the curriculum design for the undergraduate creative writing course. This course is quite new. It was the first of its kind in Brazil, and it started in 2016. And we had quite a few students until now. We welcome around 40 or 50 students every year. And it's a 5-semester course. It's shorter than other courses, but it's a very intense course where they have the opportunity to study, to share their writing, and their final paper will be something literary. And this course is delivered in English, not in English, but in Portuguese. The students have the opportunity, if they want to, they can submit their tasks or even their final paper in English, depending on the instructor, if the instructor is willing and able to evaluate a task in English. but the course itself is it's completely in Portuguese. So how do we understand an internationalization process in a whole course, undergraduate course like this? The approach we chose was to encourage diversity in all the content throughout the course. So in our reading lists, the authors, books, movements, they will be studying in their time, in their during their time in the course, will be as international as possible. So they will read people from other countries, other races, other sexualities and genders, as so we want it to be as diverse course, as diverse as we can. But that is a challenge because it requires all instructors, all teachers, every teacher to reevaluate their experience with their reading lists and their past experience as teachers. They must be willing to learn something new all the time. And we are constantly pushing and establishing dialogue between students and teachers so we can understand how to make it a more international course and a more diverse course. And I think it's a process that will never end. And it's something that we keep doing, and constantly. So the good news is that we are dealing with art, we are dealing with literature, and the artistic environment is naturally welcoming to other experiences. If you want to be an artist and if you want to study any kind of art, you must be willing to open yourself to experiences from other people, from other countries, other cultures. And I think this is what makes it a bit easier to make this course a bit more international. And we are, of course, dealing with teaching staff that is constantly doing research as well, going abroad to present papers and conducting international research with partners around the world. So that makes it easier because we have a close relationship between the undergraduate and graduate course. And that makes it a bit easier to bring something new every time the instructors or the teachers have new experiences as well. So, and how we understand quality standards in classes or in curriculum design. I think this is the easy part because everything we have done and everything we do follows quality standards that are already in place in the university. So since it's a big university that is interested in excellence, so every class and every course will be assessed constantly, and we are constantly receiving feedback from students and giving feedbacks to students after they tell us what they feel like it needs to change. And so we already have a system, a whole infrastructure of assessment and quality standards that are already used in the university. So this is a bit of my experience teaching an elective class and also coordinating an undergraduate course. And these are a little bit of our ideas, some of our ideas that we use to bring internationalization to our experience in our university. So the time is short, but if you want to write me and keep talking about it, I'd be happy to keep discussing it. So thank you.
Well, I say thank you, Dr. Bueno, for your relevant reflections on internationalization, curriculum design, and also for sharing your experience as a professor and coordinator. Now it is time for questions and answers. You can continue submitting your questions through the chat function. I'll read the questions live and Dr. Pelliccione and Dr. Bueno will answer them. I've heard Dr. Bueno has a question to Professor Dr. Pelliccione, right?
Yes, I have a. Can I ask the question? Yes,
yeah.
I'm very curious to learn how Curtin University dealt with the pandemic. How the pandemic affected your teaching and research, and what are the alternatives you found to deal with it?
That's a really good question. Very much like Brazil, the Perth campus were given very little warning to actually move totally online, but more warning than what we did in Mauritius. So in Perth, what the university actually did, they knew everything had to go online, so they actually stopped everything for a whole week. So they let the students know, because it was a government directive. So there was really no choice, like everywhere else. So they gave staff a whole week to get everything online. At Curtin, we're actually quite fortunate because we've been teaching in the online mode for a very, very long time. So many of the courses, even though we deliver them face-to-face, we were also delivering them online. But there were many courses that were not being delivered. So you can imagine, the staff and technology is my background, and I taught online a lifetime ago. So they had to move they moved very, very quickly, and it was just amazing the way they did. But we're, as you were saying, we have really good systems in place. We were using Blackboard as a learning management system. So because we had those systems and other technology to support the students, that's how we were able to. But we also got a little bit of warning early on, because what ended up happening is that because we had a number of Chinese students who could not actually come to Perth, even from December, as early as then, and even in January before everything actually happened, we were starting to prepare then. Now, why we were very fortunate in each of the global campuses is that because we had a place, because we had the support of the central repository with the Blackboard and all of those resources too. So each of the global, the satellite campuses had support, but each of the campuses also have their own very good infrastructure. And we saw it coming in Mauritius very, very quickly. So we actually mobilised systems very, very quickly, as simple as having to use WhatsApp group for students, setting up WhatsApp groups, because you can imagine in a place like Mauritius, some of the technology was not there. And so which meant we all not only had to make sure, we had to make sure that our students who were at home on their own, and some of them were international students, not only had internet connection, but also had the technology. So it meant actually getting the technology out to them because they couldn't get to the campus. I actually saw, like many of us, I think, I saw Curtin at its best. To see it, and I bet I can see it in your face. You probably feel exactly the same. You saw your university at its best. Focus on what was really important, the student and the student experience and supporting them. I'm so proud to be in education. But the assessments had to be modified. We had to track all of that. If we were going to modify an assessment, how was that going to be modified? What did that look like in the other campuses? Because, we couldn't do some of the online testing in this small window. We had to have a 24-hour window because in some of the time we would lose power. So, and we had a 72-day lockdown. And so we had the whole semester online. But second semester, we were able to go back, but now we're back to online. So there's this ebb and flow. And again, because we're a larger university, we had a lot of that technology in place. But, you know, like you, we had absolutely, there was a lot of self-learning, a lot of just-in-time learning and, you know, and staff learning with students along the way. So it was, you know, quite remarkable and, you know, and very heartwarming to see the response as to how quickly everyone moved. Yeah. Ooh, and learned very quickly. Yeah. So thank you for that. Thank you for that question. And I'm going to be really, if you don't mind, I'm going to ask a question because I love the fact that you love your creative writing. You open that up to the rest of the university. I'm from humanities. I think we should be doing more of that. And too often we have courses that are so locked in that there's no room or there isn't any space for anything else. But I think we're getting better at that. And I see that as internationalizing the curriculum, allowing other disciplines to come in. So what was your uptake in the creative writing by the psychologists and by some of these science people? So were they interested? So how, you know, what was the uptake? Because I think that's fantastic.
Thank you. Thank you for your answer. I think we had a similar experience here. We had a week of just everything stopped for a week before we had the chance to move everything to online. And the university was quick to offer training for the staff who weren't comfortable with the whole online thing. And everything went, I think, as best as it could. The students were very, very understanding and the teachers as well. And challenging, but also inspiring, yes. So about your question, my experience is that students coming to optional classes such as creative writing, they are very excited to be there because it's something they really want to do. It's not something that they are required to do because of their course, but something that they really want to try for fun, or they really want to try because they want to become writers. My understanding is some of the most excited students and participant students are the ones coming from other courses because they have one semester to study creative writing and they want to make it the best semester they can. And frequently they keep writing. Sometimes they graduate from their course and go back to creative writing officially this time. And this reflects on the graduate creative writing courses because in our creative writing masters, I think 50% of our students come from other areas. They come from not from letters or creative writing. They come from law, psychology, and more frequently journalism and communication. So best thing we can do is to open up the experience to everyone. Really, it's a great, great experience.
Yeah, no, that's wonderful. Okay. Thank you for that.
Now we have some questions. The first one I'm going to address to Dr. Pelliccione, which is, you've mentioned that at Curtin you proceed an annual review on programs. Mm-hmm. On what is it based? It means. And what happens if you find out it needs changes? What changes are allowed considering legislation and time to implement once it is annual?
That's a really good question, and that's a question from someone who actually knows about all the regulations. And at Curtin, we are a self-accrediting body, so we don't have to send because we get accredited by TEXA, and you know we've always had exceptional results. So at the annual review, what they look at is basically the student feedback, the staff feedback, They look at unit pass rates. So what is happening across the board, not just on the Perth campus, what is happening? Now, so I think they do a deep dive into that data. And if something needs to change, for example, if it's an assessment piece that needs to change, then what you do at Curtin, it's that there are different types of level changes. So if it's an assessment piece that you're changing because something really doesn't work or it didn't actually measure the learning outcomes that you really wanted to, then what you do is that you submit a change of assessment, and it actually goes through one of our teaching and learning committees. So it's really only when you're actually creating a whole new course that actually requires you have to lodge which units you're running and which courses you're running. They're the sorts of things you need to do. But we have a reasonable amount of freedom and autonomy within boundaries. For example, you know, the learning outcomes, if you want to change the learning outcomes, you need to get approval. So in other words, you know how you often get a cycle of different staff teaching different units? You know, someone goes on sabbatical or you have someone else replacing you. We need those rules in place, because what you don't want is the integrity of the unit to be changed every semester. So that's why we have these things in place. But we monitor that very closely. And then that annual review gets submitted to the course review, which is, you know, happens every 5 years. But if a course needs to change, we don't wait for 5 years. That's why you have the annual review. You can't wait 5 years. You know, that's too long. So we do this iterative process. And I hope that my explanation helped a little bit in that iterative process, because I tried to show it at the unit level. But great question. Thank you for that.
I thank you very much, Dr. Pelliccione. And now, Professor Bernardo, a question for you. Do you think that in order to incorporate internationalization in curriculum design is up to the faculty? What about institutions' role?
Okay. I think internationalization and the curriculum design is something that I think the role of the university is the biggest role here, because the university has to constantly be investing in the development of the faculty. So in courses or events like this one, or funding for research, or the creation of labs and courses, and also designing the quality standards that we need for an international course. So, of course, we need to have an internationalized faculty. Of course, it's good to have people teaching that had experience abroad or connections with other countries. But in the end, it depends on what the university wants and what the university requires for each class and each course. So when we have a push by the university encouraging internationalization, it allows the staff who have, you know, ideas or international ideas to bring those ideas to the table and make changes in the course. So I think the university comes first so that the staff, the faculty is able to make the changes, but that depends on the university.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Bernardo. Now another one for you, Professor Lina Pelliccione, which is, we heard Texa talking about quality standards,
yes,
probably in our webinar here. How do you manage meeting taxa and students' expectations and all stakeholders' expectations as well?
Another really good question. I mean, we have, Bernardo said, because we are a well-established university, we have, you know, really good mechanisms to address those standards. And if you think about it, if you have a close look at those standards, they very much focus on what's the best interest of the students anyway. They're, you know, a really high quality experience for them. And so I think, you know, managing the TEXA standards and the student expectations, they actually align, you know, so they actually align. And we have really good systems in place where, you know, when we are audited, it's actually not a huge issue, because we thought, you know, because those standards are actually naturally embedded in our everyday practice. So what I'm saying, it's not hard to do for a university as Curtin, when it's well established, has really good systems, has also really good people too, to help manage and drive some of that. But you know, one of the really good things about those standards is it's actually looking at continuous improvement. And it sounds like, and even Bernardo mentioned this, it's about constantly reflecting on what you're doing and how you're doing and how you can do it better. So I don't see the TEXA as a big stick. And you know, we don't see TEXA as a big stick, as that, oh, goodness, TEXA's coming. We actually see that, you know, these are standards, and it's actually we set our own expectations. And if you have a look at our values, one of our values is strive for excellence. And so everything we do strive for excellence. So I know that, you know, it's probably a roundabout way, but it's actually just embedded in what we do. And I'm really happy to talk to anyone offline too about any of this and how we manage it and the systems we put in place. So I'm happy to do that.
That's great. Thank you very much, Professor Bernardo. How do you assess quality in Brazil, probably in undergrad programs and in your discipline? I mean, I believe that's the institutional part. You are muted, Professor.
All right, yes. Okay, so each class, the professor that is delivering the class will have the freedom to choose how they are going to evaluate student work. So if they want a test or an essay or creative work, they can choose how to do that. In creative writing, it's common for people to think that that's hard to evaluate or assess creative writing work from students, because it is literature and it's literature and it's art, and art is subjective. But we have a number of items that we can check in a student's writing, if it makes sense, if the language is well used, if it dialogues with the tradition of literature coming before, if it is connected to the writing, the specific writing task, if the story works, if it's, what literary mechanisms the student is working with in that particular piece. But in a broader sense, in the course in university, we have several steps where we evaluate or assess the course. So we have student feedback. We also have constant meetings with just today we had a meeting with all the course coordinators discussing course assessment. And every 5 years or so, we have an assessment by the Ministry of Education. So we have a visit, a very official visit, where people come to the university to see the classrooms and talk to the students and talk to staff. And we have to prepare a number of documents and data, and they will evaluate. So we have internal evaluations and we have external evaluations as well. And it's a cycle. It happens all the time. We don't have an annual review, but we have, you know, meetings with a board of lecturers in each course. Each course will have a board that will be responsible for evaluating, assessing the assessments or so. And so we have several different steps. It's also very official and sometimes bureaucratic. We have to prepare a lot of documents. But the biggest one is the one conducted by the Ministry of Education every 5 years or so.
Thank you very much. We had another question considering how this time has provided more students to have an to develop international perspectives and intercultural competencies via virtual exchange programs like virtual mobility, COU and all that. But unfortunately, we don't have time for that. So now I thank you very much, Dr. Pelliccione and Dr. Bueno, for your very interesting discussion on quality assessment and internationalization of education by the professor perspective. This presentation has been very enriching and it will provide new relevant discussions for universities, professors, and academic as well. If you want to get a certificate of attendance for this event, please click on the link that we have sent in the chat function. Thank you everyone for attending this event and for your questions. If you have any other questions or comments to make, please send us an email. We'll be more than happy to answer your questions. The address will be available in the chat function as well. And if you are interested in all these themes or in the area of internationalization of education, please contact us and join us. The Center of Internationalization of Education, Brazil, Australia, is more than happy to welcome you all. We hope you have enjoyed this round of webinars promoted by the Center of Internationalization of Education, Brazil, Australia, focused on quality assessment and internationalization of education. Have a nice day or enjoyable evening, depending on where you are. Stay safe and see you soon. Bye-bye.